Hey, I'm Kyle from the .NET Monitor team, and today I'm really excited to do a walkthrough of one of .NET Monitor's most common use cases, running it as a sidecar in a Kubernetes cluster. This video assumes you already have some background knowledge of .NET Monitor, so if this is your first time hearing about it, I would recommend checking out the linked Getting Started guide on how to use .NET Monitor, and then coming back to this video. Today, we're going to talk a little bit about the motivations behind why you might want to use .NET Monitor as part of your Kubernetes cluster, and then we're going to walk step by step through everything you'll need to do in order to try this out for yourself. Let's get started. When it comes to running .NET applications on Windows, collecting and analyzing diagnostic artifacts is pretty well documented. However, we recognize that a lot of customers moving to Linux and Kubernetes might struggle to find parity with diagnostics tools available for .NET. In this video, we're going to dive into how .NET Monitor can help improve the observability, collection, and egress of artifacts for .NET apps running on Linux, specifically with Kubernetes. For this tutorial, we're going to employ something known as the Sidecar Pattern. In this pattern, we'll have two containers in the same pod, our .NET app and .NET Monitor. As a brief refresher, in Kubernetes, the pod is the smallest unit of scale that we work with, and it can hold multiple containers that all share that pod's resources. The sidecar is another container that's located alongside your .NET app in the same pod, and this means that the sidecar can attach to the parent application and provide diagnostics without requiring you to add diagnostics tooling to your main app's container. To better visualize what's going on here, let's take a quick look at this diagram. In this scenario, our sample user app provides a service to the public internet, and .NET Monitor sits alongside the application, providing diagnostics functionality in a container that isn't publicly exposed. This helps you keep your container small while benefiting from the tools made available through .NET Monitor. It's time to deploy our cluster to production. Naturally, your deployment strategy will vary depending on your choice of cloud provider and CLI. For this particular scenario, though, I'll be using the Kubernetes command line client with Azure. We'll start out by logging into our Azure Container Registry, and then we'll create a Kubernetes cluster. We want to make sure that our context is set to our new cluster, so we'll do that here, and then we can use the following command to make sure our context is set correctly. Finally, we can verify that our nodes are up and running. Fortunately for us, it looks like everything is good to go, so we can start setting up our configuration. The first step in getting this up and running will be creating a YAML file for a simple two-container configuration. We're not going to go too in-depth here with the YAML configuration, but if you need a refresher, you can follow the link in the description for a tutorial that'll walk you through deploying a multi-container group with a YAML file. To make it easier for you to follow along, there's a provided link to our sample manifest, which is what I'll be using here. I'm going to skim over some of this, but I'll talk through a couple of the important points that you'll need for using .NET Monitor as a sidecar. The first container in the group defines our sample internet-facing web application. As you can see here, we've already published our application's image and we're able to reference it with its identifier. This is where you'd insert your application's image, but if you want to follow along with the demo when we collect some artifacts later on in this video, you can use our image. The second container, or our sidecar, is where .NET Monitor lives. This would be completely separate from your application and it's solely for helping to collect diagnostics from the first container. To give you a better feel for all the different ways that you can configure .NET Monitor, we're going to use a combination of environment variables, ConfigMaps, and a settings.json file. Ultimately, it's up to you how you prefer to write configuration, but this should give you an idea of some of the different options that you have. For more detailed information about the different configuration sources .NET Monitor supports, we'll leave a link to our documentation. Here, we've set a few environment variables to enable collection rules, as well as a corresponding environment variable on our test app. We'll be relying on projected volumes to access our ConfigMaps and secrets, .NET Monitor egress, .NET Monitor triggers, and API key, and we'll set those up in a minute. And finally, we'll also be using .NET Monitor's recommended container limits, which you can learn more about in our documentation. Next, we need to add our config maps. So that you don't need to write your own, you can follow the link to access these files, and we're going to be creating two config maps, .NET Monitor egress and .NET Monitor triggers. For .NET Monitor egress, we'll be setting up Azure egress using managed identity authentication. We'll name our egress provider Monitor Blob, and this is the name that we'll use to reference it later when we want to send artifacts to Azure Blob Storage. Note that this is only available in .NET Monitor 6.2 and above, and for earlier versions of .NET Monitor, you can authenticate using your account key as shown in our documentation. Now, let's head into our Azure portal and go to our storage account, specifically looking at access control. We're going to add a new role assignment for our target application's agent pool called Storage Blob Data Contributor. This is going to enable us to send our artifacts from .NET Monitor to our storage account without having to share any secret information with Dotnet-Monitor. Under Members, I'm going to assign access to a Managed Identity, and then after selecting my subscription and setting my Managed Identity to be a User-Assigned Managed Identity, we can select our agent pool. Finally, after we finished our role assignment, we can grab our client ID by going into our resource JSON view, and we're going to copy that into our config map to link our app with the storage account. We're also going to set up a local file system egress. We'll name this monitor file, and we'll list the path where we want our artifacts to be egressed. Now, let's go ahead and add in our config map to Dotnet Monitor, and we can use the following command to make sure that Dotnet Monitor pulls in the egress configuration that we just wrote. Next, let's also load in our settings.json file that contains a sample collection rule using the following command. We'll try out a sample collection rule scenario in a little bit to help us check if we've configured everything correctly. Finally, we need to set up authentication. Though Dotnet Monitor can be run without authentication by using the no auth flag, you should only disable authentication once you have evaluated and mitigated the security implications of doing so. Let's run the generate key command to get an API key that we can use for authentication. That'll give us our subject, public key, and bearer token. We'll use that subject and public key to create a secret using kubectl, but keep the bearer token handy because we'll need it in just a little bit. Once we've done that, we'll double check that everything worked as expected using the following commands. We should be able to see our config maps and secret here, which fortunately we do. We're almost ready to start collecting diagnostics, but first we'll need to apply the manifest that we looked at in the previous section so that it takes effect. Give this a few seconds, and then if we check on the state of our pods, if we've done everything correctly, our pod should say that it's running, which it does. We can check on Dotnet Monitor's logs now, and we'll get a bunch of messages indicating that Dotnet Monitor is up and running, as well as any warning messages that can help us determine if we've made a mistake in our configuration. Fortunately for us, everything here looks good, and it also looks like our collection rules are up and running, so now we can start using Dotnet Monitor with our target app. In order to control Dotnet Monitor locally while it's running in your cluster, you'll need to port forward traffic from your host to your target cluster. To do this, let's get the name of the pod that we want to forward traffic to using the same command that we just used a little bit ago. Once you have your target pod name, all we actually have to do is forward the traffic for Dotnet Monitor and our target app using the following command. Now that we've started forwarding traffic from our local network to the desired pod, we can make API calls to get diagnostics from Dotnet Monitor about our app. To see the full list of things that you can do with the Dotnet Monitor API, take a look at our documentation, but just to make sure that things are working as expected, we can try out a few examples. Let's check to see what processes Dotnet Monitor finds. Naturally, we should expect to see our target application show up, and here we can see its PID, UID, and name, which will be helpful if we end up having multiple processes and we need to identify a specific one. To make sure we can collect artifacts and egress them locally into our Azure Blob storage, let's collect a GC dump on our process using curl and set our Azure egress provider to monitor blob, which is what we named our Azure egress in configuration. Give this a few seconds, and then in Azure, we can see that our GC dump has successfully shown up. Now, let's change our request by setting the egress provider to monitor file, which is what we named our local file egress in configuration. To get to our artifact, we'll exec into our monitor container using the following command, and then we'll navigate to our egress directory. As you can see, our GC dump is right where it's supposed to be, so both of our egress providers are working as expected. The last thing we want to do is make sure we can collect artifacts automatically using collection rules. For the purposes of this demo, we'll be using a very simple rule in order to verify that things are working as expected, but you could take a look at our documentation for more examples of what you can do with collection rules. Our rule states that we should collect a dump if our target application returns a status code in the 400s range. This is something that we can easily trigger ourselves to verify that it's working, and we'll use curl to attempt to reach an invalid page on our target application. Now, if we head over to Azure, we should see two artifacts, our GC dump from earlier, and the one our collection rule automatically collected just now. At this point, we've covered all of the fundamentals for getting Dotnet Monitor up and running in Kubernetes, which means that you should have all of the building blocks you need to help you use Dotnet Monitor in your own scenarios. If you have any questions or feedback, feel free to leave them in our survey or to create an issue on our GitHub page. For more information on how to use Dotnet Monitor, we'll continue adding tutorials to the linked playlist with more scenarios and new features coming soon. Thanks for watching.